Victorian horse-drawn omnibuses were transport for the masses in the 19th century, common to the streets of London since 1829, and cheaper than travel by cab. A whole plethora of competing companies vied for trade until regulated in 1855. This didn't put a stop to complaints of bus drivers racing each other in competition for the best routes, not to mention the noise, commotion, and surly nature of the drivers. Of course, the unceasing march of industrialization and progress signaled the end for horse-drawn buses, and a business which demanded a complicated system of feeding, stabling, and fresh horses throughout the day. Horse cars on rails, tram lines, and railways had power and capacity for many more passengers and were soon replacing less efficient horse-drawn buses in the latter years of the 19th century. It is against this background of technological and cultural change in transport that we meet Cast Iron Billy, a veteran bus driver struggling to adapt to a changing world powered by animals to one of machines. He tells us the story of his life and career as told in an account from Street Life in London, 1877, by John Thomson and Adolphe Smith, and is narrated in the words of Smith. Thomson was a talented and influential photographer who joined with Smith, a journalist, in a project to photograph the street life of London's poor. The authors were careful not to varnish their words for an audience. What they saw and heard accurately reflects their interactions with everyday people and genuinely immerses the reader in authentic Victorian street life. You can check the in-video cards and description for links to more interesting videos about the Victorians. In particular, we have Street Life in London from the same authors, which opens a window on more genuinely wonderful characters from Victorian London and the hard lives they led. Do check it out. Before we start, please consider clicking the subscribe button in the bottom right of your screen for more content like this. If you find this video interesting, I would really appreciate it if you could give it a thumbs up and share it widely with friends and family. These two things really do show your support and help the channel grow so I can bring you more. Thank you.
43 years on the road and more, said Cast Iron Billy. But for my rheumatics, I feel almost as hale and hearty as any gentleman could wish. But I'm lost. I've been put off my perch. I don't mind telling of you I'm not so handy with the ribbons as in my younger days I was. Twice in my life I've been put off, and this finishes me. I'll never hold the whip again that's been in my hand these 43 years. Never! I can't sit at home. My perch up there was more home to me than anything. Having lost that, I'm no good to nobody. A fish out of water, I be.
William Peregrine, known as Cast Iron Billy, may be said to have commenced life with the whip in his hand. With an inborn aptitude for the profession, he took to the road early. Whip in hand, he mounted his father's cab and continued for some years to pilot the vehicle through the busy streets of London. In the days when the Royal Mails ran from the post office with their armed guards and passengers prepared for long, weary journeys, William was fired with the ambition to drive some more imposing conveyance than the old four-wheeler. At last his hopes were realized, and he commenced his career as omnibus driver on the London roads. This event was indelibly fixed in his memory, as it happened in 1834, when the old Houses of Parliament were destroyed by fire. The first locomotive was running successfully between Manchester and Liverpool, although it was regarded by many as a foolhardy experiment that would speedily come to an end. The first accident on the rails led our hero to believe that the new mode of travelling would not answer.
There was safety and comfort in the old mail, But to be smashed up into minced meat by steam is the sort of thing folks wouldn't stand. But he has advanced with the times, and now regards the railroad as the great feeder of his own and every other sort of labour in the metropolis. 2 or 3 years later, William engaged himself to the London Conveyance Company. After 14 years' faithful service, the stock was sold off, and he was discharged.
Don't know if they was broke or what. They sold off.
He next found employment with a job master for about 12 months, but in the end was turned adrift, and 2 years elapsed before he again obtained regular employment. This, he assured me, was the only time in his life in which he came to grief. Fortune smiled once more, and he entered as driver to the London General Omnibus Company, in whose service he has ended his career on the road.
Now,
he pathetically remarked,
I'm too old to look ahead. There's the workhouse on one side. It's not pleasant. And who knows, on t'other, perhaps some sporting gent wanting me to keep his gate. I might do that. You see, I could sit in front 14 hour out of the 24. Always handy.
This, then, is the poor man's paradise, to have some settled spot where he could sit out his days, in imagination, perched on his old seat above his steady-going cattle. He confessed that the post would have its drawbacks. He would miss the scenes of city life, the traffic of the streets, the excitement of racing against opposition. He would miss, too, the greeting of his old patrons, whose front seats were held sacred for the morning and evening journeys. He would lose the run of those whom he had carried to and fro for years, and who, owing to the punctuality of his omnibus at the corner, had risen to fame and fortune. Unlike a well-known aged driver on another metropolitan route who has amassed £2,000, William was never able to do more than keep things going at home. His first wife was for many years an invalid and a drain on his resources. His children, who were sickly, needed constant tending. Nor is his poverty to be attributed to intemperance, although he owned to taking a drop of liquor to keep the frost out in winter and stave off the heat in summer. He also defied any man to say that he had seen him drunk, when he should have been sober.
Nothing like old Schuyler, one of the best whips on the road. He's over 70, and rides job and post, or drives to the Derby four in hand, but he never goes to bed sober. Not if he knows it. He'll swallow more dog noses in a journey than most men living.
The subject of the photograph lost his position as driver, owing to his inability to cope with younger men driving opposition omnibuses along the same route. In this instance, the omnibuses crossed each other, the younger and more active men so taking the lead as to pick up all the passengers. This was not all. Our veteran had become so enfeebled as to require help to mount his perch, while the reins had to be secured to his coat, as he has partially lost the use of his left hand. The practice of racing, to the detriment of vehicles and discomfort of passengers, has been in vogue for half a century, but my informant remarked that in the
good old days,
the struggle raged more fiercely than it does now. Then there were many small proprietors running a neck and neck race for a living. The large companies which now monopolize the routes have in some measure tended to check the evil. At the same time, the daily earnings of each conveyance depend so much on the joint efforts of driver and conductor that they do not scruple to urge on their steeds when it suits their convenience. The demands thus made upon the strength of the horses soon renders them unfit for the road. I have been assured by more authorities than one that such horses as are employed will, on an average, stand omnibus work no longer than 8 years.
It is curious to observe that both horse and conveyance must be renewed at about the same time. I gather from the police report for 1875 that in 6 years, 8,180 public conveyances were condemned as unfit for use. In 1875, 9,684 licenses were granted for public conveyances in the metropolitan district. It will be seen, therefore, that the whole of the public conveyances of London are renewed about every 8 years. The number of omnibuses running last year within the metropolitan area was 1,448 horses, allowing 10 to each omnibus, 14,480 drivers, conductors, and horsekeepers, 4,344. The men employed in omnibus work are, as a class, fairly healthy, notwithstanding their exposure to all weathers, and that they labour 14 hours out of every 24. The supply of men flows from a great variety of sources. The majority of the drivers have been trained early in the management of horses. In some cases, the education thus bestowed has been so purely professional as to leave the men ignorant of the most rudimentary branches of knowledge. For all that, some of them have filled better positions. They have owned their own studs and driven their own coaches. One I may mention was at one time a man of property and an authority on all matters relating to the turf. Early in life, he made up his mind, seemingly to spend his money and to live merrily while it lasted, and when his funds were gone, he settled down, cheerfully enough, to driving an omnibus. Quite recently, he has come in for a windfall in the shape of a legacy of over £1,000. Immediately on his receiving the money, he descended from his perch and was last seen lolling over the bar of a restaurant, smoking a fragrant cigar, and wearing a suit most horsey and juvenile. A white hat, tilted so as to partially shade the left eye, would have completed his attire, but for a narrow black band with which it was adorned. The band was possibly worn in grateful remembrance of the friend who left him the money, or for the money that had already gone in procuring some fleeting pleasure for its owner. Be that as it may, when the legacy has been squandered, its owner will doubtless resume his seat on the box. Omnibus conductors are drawn from the ranks of unfortunate clerks, mechanics, and tradesmen of all sorts. No special training being required for the duties of a conductor, the post is open to all comers who can read and write, and who can produce some satisfactory reference as to character. The pay is 4 shillings a day, but the black mail, extracted from them in various ways, renders it almost impossible for them to exist on their pay, there being, moreover, no proper check on their drawings. The men are exposed to the greatest temptations. It is in some instances tacitly understood by employers that the taxes imposed on conductors for tips and treats to driver, horsekeeper, etc., etc., shall be taken from the fares. Were this not so, and the conductor strictly honest, his 14 hours' work would go for next to nothing.